So Revelation chapter 1, let me kind of review where we've been this morning. There are three parts to every letter, every proper letter. Number one, there is the salutation. That's who the letter is written to. We've seen that the lesser letters, these seven letters, they are written to seven literal local churches in Asia Minor. And though these letters are not to us, they are doubtless for us. Secondly, we looked at the substance of the letter and asked the question, what does the letter have to say? What's it about? And the body of this letter can be separated into two divisions, the things which are and the things which will be. We started last week on the signature, asking the question, who wrote the letter? Remember, we talked a little bit briefly last week about the fact that a signature reveals not only the name, but the nature of a person. That a trained specialist can look at a signature and tell you a lot about your character traits. They can tell you whether you're right-handed or left-handed. They can tell if you're angry. They can tell a whole lot about you just by looking at your signature. There are several things that the signature of God in this letter reveals about our God. Four things, really. We looked at three of them last week. Number one, we saw that God is, I must not put these up there, God is immeasurable. So He is eternal without beginning or end. We saw that God is immutable. He is unchanging. He is what He was, and what He was, He always will be. We saw that He is inconceivable and that He is Trinitarian and He is not the product of man's imagination. We're going to pick up on the fourth. Let me see how I've got this up here. Oh, they were up there. I just skipped them. We're going to pick up on the fourth this morning, and I want you to look at the wording of the fourth thing that this tells us about God, about His signature. The fourth thing we're going to see is that God, He is individuals. Now, how many of you have already picked up on the typo error? How many of you have already picked up on something wrong with this? The very wording of that phrase doesn't look right, does it? The subject is singular, but the object is plural, and you may immediately think that was a typo. He got that one wrong. But this is exactly what I meant to say. Only in God can, and only in God does, this kind of massive singularity and plurality meet without any contradiction. Again, I say God, He is not individual, but individuals. As we discovered last week, He's not one in a million, He's three in one. When we say He's three in one, we don't mean He's three different expressions of one individual. We mean that He is three individuals with one essence. So let me explain the difference. I can say I'm a pastor, I'm a husband, I'm a friend. These three words describe individual roles that I play, individual roles I perform, but they don't actually render me three separate people. Although some would say I'm body, soul, and spirit, I'm still one person. I may fill different roles, but I'm one person. God, however, is not one being with three different roles or three different ways of expressing Himself. God is three unique beings that together compose one unique deity. Some may wonder, why does the Trinity matter? What's the big deal? Well, one of the reasons the Trinity matters is it matters because this is how God has revealed Himself. Now, yes, the word Trinity is never used in Scripture, but God has clearly revealed Himself as one being, three persons, one being. The reason it matters because to deny the Trinity or to doubt the Trinity is to deny or to doubt God's own self-revelation. To try to explain away the Trinity or to try to do away with it is to say, you say, God, you say you're this, but I think you're that. To do away with the Trinity is to reduce God to our level. And again, we don't want a God that is so easily explainable. Again, the signature on the end of this letter, if you will, the signature gives us some insight into the person and the work of each of the three names composed on the autograph. Although the revelation reveals the victorious Christ, the letter bears the markings of each member of the Godhead and reveals something about their unique role and function in the Trinity. So remember, this letter, again, is from Revelation 1, 4 through 5. It's from Him who is and who was and who is to come. That's the Father. It's from the seven spirits who are before the throne. That's the Spirit. And verse 5 says it's from Jesus Christ. So I want to look at these three members of the Godhead individually this morning, how they contribute to the letter, and how all three autographs really make one signature. Number one, let's look at the Father. The first of the three to be identified is the Father. He is referred to as Him who is, who was, and who is to come. The Father is, the best way I know to express it, the Father is chief among His equals. Though the three in the Trinity are co-equal, the Scripture certainly represents a hierarchy of submission in the Godhead. And even I wrestle with the way to word that, because they are completely co-equal, yet Scripture at the same time makes it plain that the Father, it's evident, the Father is superior to the other two in some sense. Think about this. In His earthly ministry, Jesus often referred to the will of the Father and submitted Himself to it. Jesus did nothing without the Father's consent. John 6:38, Jesus said, "I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of Him who sent me." Matthew 26:39, when Jesus was in the garden, He went a little further and He fell on His face and He prayed and He said, "Oh, my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as You will." Even though the three members of the Trinity are co-equal and co-existent, at the same time there seems to be this hierarchy, if you will, where God reigns, the Father reigns as supreme. Jesus Himself seems to acknowledge that as He submitted Himself to the will of the Father. And this is not in my notes this morning, but I do just want to point out, if God the Son, if Jesus Christ submitted Himself in this way to the Father, what excuse do any of us have to not submit to the Father? The Father is supreme. These four words must cause us to stop and think. I said the Father is supreme. There can be no argument that the will of the Father is the supreme ideal of the Spirit and of the Son. Let's ask this though. If this is the supreme goal of the Spirit and the Son, is it the goal of His people? Jesus, who was fully equal with the Father, submitted Himself to the will of the Father, yet we who are unequal, who are less than Jesus, resist the will of the Father. So there's one question I want you to answer for that. Why? Honestly, answer for yourself, why is it that we so resist the will of the Father? Shouldn't our prayer be, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven"? And when we pray that, shouldn't we be including this little piece of dirt, this little piece of earth that was made from the dirt? Shouldn't we include ourselves in that? Can we honestly pray, "Thy will be done on earth," and not be fully including ourselves in that prayer? Jesus' attitude towards the Father, towards the Father's ways, was, "Thy will be done through me, in me, and by me." And for Jesus, that meant sorrow. Yes, at times it meant joy, but it meant times of deep sorrow. But yet Jesus' heart cry was, "The will of the Father be done." As best I understand, you might correct me on this later, and if you have Scripture to correct me, I'm fine with that. As best I understand, the Father has never been seen, and I don't know that the Father will ever be seen. I think that the best way I understand Scripture is that Jesus is the only human expression. Jesus is the only visible form of the Father. Now, if you have Scripture to back that, to prove that differently, please show me, because I would like to know that. The Father, as best I understand, has never been seen. He is the invisible one, and though His lips have never been seen, His voice can be heard in every word of this letter. This is from the supreme being writing to the church, and what He says is authoritative, but it, because it is from the one who is supreme. Remember in verse 1, it was the Father who gave the revelation to the Son to in turn give it to His people. So when reading the book of Revelation, there should be no doubt that these are the authoritative words of a father to his children. The second member identified is not just the Father, the second member identified is the Spirit. Notice someone even asked me, a couple people asked me about this last week because we didn't get this far. Notice the text says that there are these seven spirits that are before the throne. So I was asked last week, who are these seven spirits? The seven spirits in verse 4, remember, refer to one member of the Trinity, and that is obviously the member we call the Holy Spirit. Now, I think it would be negligent of us here if we assumed, because of this verse, that the Holy Spirit was seven spirits who constituted one spirit. I don't think that's what's being said here. One of the difficulties in studying, especially the book of Revelation, is knowing how to rightly divide the imagery that it presents sometimes. Knowing, is this literal, is this figurative? But one of the best ways that often we can answer that is we can solve the problem by allowing the Scripture to be its own interpreter. The plural description of the Spirit is a reference back to Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 10. The word is asked, and you've heard this part of the first part of the verse before. Who's despised the day of small things? For these seven, talking about the eyes of God, these seven rejoice to see the plumb line in the hand of Zerubbabel. They are the eyes of the Lord which scan to and fro throughout the earth. The idea here is not that there are literally, I don't think, that there are literally seven spirits in one spirit. The idea here is referring back to Zechariah, and maybe what John saw was seven spirits before the throne. But I don't think what we're being told is that the spirit actually is seven spirits. What we're being told here is that the spirit serves as the eyes of God. The Spirit searches the earth. He sees all that it is. He tries the hearts of men. The Spirit is the active arm, if you will, of the Godhead. Now, I've never been one to put much stock in numerology. Numerology is a doctrine whereby men interpret the numbers of Scripture. The reason I don't put a lot of stock in it is because people tend to take it way too far. Right? They'll take a few verses from Daniel or a few verses from Revelation, and they'll say, well, this number here and this number here, you add it together, you get 666, and whoever's the president at the time, that's the way they prove he's the Antichrist. Right? It doesn't matter who the president is, he's the Antichrist because they got it from the numbers of Scripture. I don't put a lot of stock in numerology because sometimes it's taken way too far. Yet, at the same time, there's no argument amongst any Bible student that certain numbers have clear meanings and clear associations in Scripture. The number seven is, of course, the number of completion. God created in 7 days, and on six days, and on the seventh day, He rested. I think the seven eyes of God here are meant to convey not a literal seven spirits. They are meant to convey the complete and the complex vision of God. Literally, the Spirit sees all. God's vision is complete. Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 3 says, "The eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good." In other words, the eyes of the Lord face in every direction at all times. You might have said about your mom or some teacher, it's like she has eyes in the back of her head. The reality is God doesn't have eyes in the back of His head. He has seven eyes that behold everything. They're pointing in all directions at all times. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 13 tells us that there is no creature hidden from His sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. You see, the Spirit sees the things that no one else does, and the interesting thing is the Spirit never misunderstands or misinterprets what He sees. Have you ever seen something and got the completely wrong idea from what you saw? And it's not till later when you've told everybody else about it already and can't take it back that you find out that you completely got it wrong? You see, with the Spirit, it's not only that the Spirit sees everything, but He never misinterprets the facts that He takes in. As God, again, He is as much God as the Father, as much God as the Son. So as God, He is immeasurable, immutable, and inconceivable like we looked at last week. The Spirit possesses all the power of the Father. He possesses all the compassion of the Son. And that's important because in the chapters that are going to follow, it is the Spirit who reveals the true state of the church. It's the Spirit who investigates the secret closets of the hearts. It's the Spirit, the seven eyes, who bring His findings before the court. Can I tell you something? There is nothing hidden that will not be brought into the light. There is nothing hidden in your life or mine that will not be made manifest because the seven eyes of God see everything. The Spirit sees everything, good and bad, going on in the earth. Not just, imagine the immensity of this. It's not just that the Spirit sees everything you do and hears every thought you think. It's not just that, but at simultaneously, the Spirit, as you're sitting here this morning, the thoughts you're thinking, He knows them. He's interpreting them. He's seeing your reaction to His Word. As you're sitting here, He's looking at every person individually. He's looking at every person in America this morning, and He is seeing and hearing the dreams of every dreaming person in China all at the same time. I mean, just the immensity of who God is, that literally nothing escapes His view. And He is the one that's about to reveal these seven churches. He's going to reveal their triumphs. He's going to reveal their failures. His eyes are eyes that never grow weak. They never grow weary. The seven eyes are never heavy with sleep. The seven spirits are always awake. See, the Spirit is not the lesser of the three. He is equal to the other two, yet He submits Himself to the Father. He promotes the Son. He sees all. That in some way ought to inspire us, and in some way it ought to give us an even greater reverence for not just who God is. Yes, He's holy, and holy not just being that He's pure, but He's holy in that He's the God who sees and hears every thought and every action at all times from every people. He is that kind of immense God. This is who the Spirit is. That should lead us to awe and to reverence of who God is, but it should also lead us to a certain amount of holy fear. He sees. Right? We're not getting anything by Him. We're not getting anything over on Him. And these seven churches, one of them were even going to be told, you look healthy, but in fact you're not. See, the Spirit sees what's really going on the inside, not just what's on the outside. The Spirit is important to these letters because He reveals the seven eyes, the seven spirits. He reveals the complete truth of what's really going on. As fully God, the Spirit is to be treasured. Think about this. Were it not for the eyes of God, we would be blind to the truth. Were it not for the eyes of God seeing through us and revealing us to ourselves, has the Holy Spirit ever showed you something about yourself that you would have just never seen or never thought to be true had He not said it? Were it not for the eyes of God, we would be blind, not just to Him, but to ourselves. As we walk through these seven churches and as the Holy Spirit speaks to you individually, remember, this is not coming from some voice who just thought he saw something one time. This is coming from the voice who sees everything and rightly interprets it. The Spirit signs this letter, His mark. His mark is the mark of truth. Let's move on thirdly this morning. The third party of the signature is, of course, Jesus Christ. John gives six accolades to the Son. In fact, he focuses on the Son in more detailed fashion, and that really makes sense because the Son is actually the focus of the book of Revelation. We often tend to think that the book of Revelation is all about telling us what's coming, and in a sense it is. But the book of Revelation is actually the revelation of the victorious Christ. It's showing us the triumph, the current triumph and the coming triumph of Jesus Christ. The book of Revelation is not just about beast and women riding on something with seven heads and this one and this little goat with 10 horns. I mean, that's not all the revelation is about. The revelation is the revealing of the victorious Jesus Christ. So it makes sense that he focuses on the Son in a more detailed sense. First of all, I want you to notice that he calls the Son the faithful witness. Verse number 5, this letter is from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness. There are many ways, but just two I want to focus on, in which Christ is the faithful witness. First, he is the true witness of the Father. Jesus shares with us what he has seen, what he has experienced of the Father from eternity. Jesus' testimony regarding the Father is not hearsay. Jesus' testimony is firsthand experience. Now, I will say to you sometimes, I heard a preacher say one time, or I heard this, but those are not really my firsthand thoughts. That's not coming from firsthand knowledge. When Jesus speaks of God, he never says, I heard someone else say this about God. When Jesus speaks of God, he is speaking not just from firsthand hearing, from firsthand knowledge, but from eternal experience. He has spent eternity, and that's even hard for us to get our minds around, right? We think of eternity as something in the future, but eternity is just as much something in the past. God is the eternal God who has always been and always will be. Jesus has been with the Father for eternity already, without beginning and without end. And it is his experience of the Father that he conveys to us. John chapter 8 and verse 14, Jesus answered and said to them, even if I bear witness of myself, my witness is true, for I know where I came from and where I'm going. We know the Father how? Through the Son. In fact, you remember, I didn't put the scripture on the screen, but you remember, was it Thomas or Andrew? One of them said to him, you know, show us the Father. Right? And we'll be satisfied. And Jesus says, how long have I been with you? And you don't get it. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. We know the Father through the Son. He is the faithful witness of the Father. But he's not just the faithful witness of the Father. Second, he's the faithful witness of the future. God gave this revelation to the Son, and Jesus delivered to John that which was delivered to him without alteration or exaggeration. This morning I was praying and I had to admit before God, and you know, we do this not intentionally, but it's still sin. I was praying this morning and I just kind of got to thinking about some things I'd said and knowing that, I exaggerated the story. It made it funnier, but it didn't make it truer. And even just the slight exaggeration for a little humor may not be a big deal. But what I want you to see, it actually falls short of the glory of God because Jesus is the true witness who never exaggerates, never tells anything that is not fully and wholly true. Jesus delivered to John what was delivered to him without alteration, without exaggeration. He gave to John exactly what was given to him regarding the unfolding of coming events. Jesus is the faithful witness, not just of the Father, but of the future. Second, not only is he the faithful witness, John says of these six things, he is the firstborn from the dead. Now, this wording itself here, I think, is meaningful. I want you to think about that phrase, firstborn from the dead, and it's rare that we associate death with birth in a positive sense. In fact, really, outside of the plant world, if we're talking about human life, we do not think of death and birth being one thing. The only time that death and birth are synonymous is when a mother dies giving birth, and that's not a positive thing. The wording is meaningful when it says that he is the firstborn from the dead. It's rare that we associate death with birth in a positive sense. Yet notice this, in Jesus, the two become one. Of course, it was through his death that he brought new life. His death was, in essence, the womb that gave birth to our life. The fact that Jesus here is not called the only one born from the dead. He's called the firstborn. That's significant. You see, Jesus was the first to be risen from the dead, but he will not be the last. He was the first to pass through the portal of death into a new, eternal, and indestructible life, but he will not be the last one to pass through the portal of death into a new, eternal, and indestructible life. As 1 Corinthians 13 tells us, Jesus is the first fruits of the resurrection. In other words, Jesus was the first seed planted, so as the first seed planted, he was the first seed raised. But just as much as Jesus was the first seed planted and the first seed raised, he will not be the last seed planted, nor will he be the last seed raised. For those in Christ, death is like a mother's labor. It's difficult, it's hard, it's painful, but death is, for the believer, only the prelude to birth. Death is only a passage that we go through into life. Jesus here, John tells us, is the firstborn from the dead, and we are his brothers and sisters. What I mean by that is he's the firstborn, and every other member of the family will be born in the same way as well, through death into life. To the suffering churches now, why is this meaningful? And you may be thinking, man, you're going way too far with all this. We just want to get to the seven churches. But again, think about this. To the suffering churches, this is meaningful. This is precious. To the churches, there's one of the churches that we're going to look at where he's told, you're going to be killed. Right, you're going to be killed for my name's sake. And to that suffering church, don't you think it was meaningful and precious to realize that Jesus is the firstborn from the dead? That just like he went through the passage and came out alive on the other side, so will we. It was a reminder to these churches that the worst possibility they faced for their faith had already been overcome by the one who they were placing their faith in. Jesus was the first one to pass through the womb of death, but he was not the last. Don't you think that was meaningful to the church? Thirdly, John tells us that he is the ruler over the kings of the earth. Now, we often say that Jesus is King of Kings, and he is, but I don't know if we really take into consideration what that means. Jesus presides over the affairs and the destinies of nations and of men with or without their consent. The king is no less king because a few peasants deny his authority. Jesus is, John writes here, this letter is from the undeniable sovereign Lord over all the earth. Again, why is that important? Well, we're not going to go into it because we've talked about it so much recently, but he places kings on the throne. He pulls kings off the throne. He turns the hearts of the king like rivers of water wherever he wills. Why does that matter to the church? Why does that matter to these churches that he's writing to? Why does it matter to us? To the churches under the pressure to bow to political coercion, this would have encouraged them to remain strong. No matter what measure of control Caesar seizes, God is in ultimate control of Caesar. Again, do you see why this was significant to the life of these suffering churches? He is the ruler over the kings of the earth. And notice it does not say he will be. He already is. Yes, there's going to come a day where he is enthroned, literally on the new earth. And if you want to hear more about that, you can buy my book in a couple months. There will come a day. You're supposed to laugh there. There will come a day where he is literally enthroned on the earth. But we're not waiting for that day for him to be king. He is the ruler of the kings of the earth already. Another thing, a fourth thing John tells us about him is that Now, John kind of switches here, but still, we're looking at the signature. John tells us that he is the one who loved us. He is mighty, He is merciful, He is magnificent, but wonder of wonders, the wonder of all wonders, is not that He is the ruler over all the earth. It's not that He's the firstborn from the dead. It's not that He's the faithful witness. Those are wonderful things, but the real wonder here is that He is the one that John says, Him who loved us. The fourth accolade is special because it's preceded by the first three. This is not just some random guy off the street who loves us. It's the faithful witness of the Father, the faithful witness of the future. It's the one who is the Lord over all. It's the firstborn from the dead. And according to John, He is the one who loves us. To the considerate heart, it's a wonder that a king would ever love a peasant. It's beyond comprehension that life would allow Himself to be swallowed by death so that He could rescue those who were already in the belly of death. The death of Jesus, literally, He allowed Himself to be swallowed by death so that He could cut His way out of the belly and we could follow Him out. That's a wonder. Why would the faithful witness, it's a question that we have to wrestle with, why would the faithful witness love an unfaithful bride? That is beyond our comprehension. Yet the letter itself, you say, well, I want to know, does God love me? The letter itself is proof that He does. And it may be in a different way than you think, though. These seven letters are love letters. But I tell you, if I send a love letter like some of these to my wife, I don't know what kind of reaction I'm going to get. These seven letters are love letters, but at times it's not going to seem like they are. Especially when He says, if you don't get things in order, I'm going to come and wipe you out. That doesn't sound very loving, does it? These seven letters, though, are love letters. It's hard for a child to understand that correction comes from love and not hatred, but it does. Remember in Hebrews, we're told that not to forget the exhortation which speaks to you as son. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord. Don't be discouraged when you're rebuked by Him. Verse 6 of Hebrews chapter 12 says, for whom the Lord loves, He chastens and scourges every son He receives. See, these letters, even when they're involved with correction, these letters are love letters. The seemingly harsh words that Christ speaks to the church, especially the church in Laodicea. Remember, He says, I'm going to spit you out. Does that sound very loving? I want you to understand this, though. It may not sound very loving to our ears, but those words were born not of spite, but of affection. God wanted them to turn around to experience the fullness of His fellowship, what He had created them for, and He told them, I'm going to spit you out, not because He hated them, but because He loved them. The letters themselves are the proof of God's love for His people. He corrects those He loves. Can any of us look to the Scriptures with sincerity and not see the love of God on full display? Even His hardest sayings are evidence of His great love for His people. He is the one who loved us and loves us still. And wonder of wonders, He is the one who is and was and is to come. His love will never end. Number five, He is the one who washed us from our sins in His own blood. The word washed, I'm not going to spend a lot of time here, but the word washed may be better translated as released. In fact, in some texts it'll say washed, others it'll say released. Really, both words are conveying the same idea though. Through the offering of His own blood, Jesus has removed from us the stain of sin. Think about it this way. When you've got a stain on your shirt, that stain to some degree imprisons you. Because you walk around like this all day because you don't want anybody to see it. That little stain actually becomes a prison, something you have to cover up. And instead of you covering it up, it actually ends up covering you up. What Jesus has done in washing us, see, the washing and the freeing, the washing and the releasing us are really the same thing. In removing the stain, He has released us from the shame of the stain. We don't have to walk around covering up the stain anymore. We walk around with our arms lifted up because the stain is gone. Through the blood, Jesus has washed us from the stain. He has removed the stain. He has released us from the shame. He has released us from the hold it has on us. This letter, if for no other reason that we should value these letters, we should value them because they are written from the one who loved us so much. He washed us from our sins in His own blood. Number six, finally, this letter is from, John tells us, it's from Him who has made us kings and priests to God. To Him who has made us kings and priests to His God and Father. I quickly want to go through this, but I do want to point some important things out here. First, I want you to see it says that He's made us kings. Notice that Jesus didn't just deliver us from something. Jesus delivered us to something. We get so focused, and so we should, on the fact that Jesus has saved us from our sin. But it's not just that Jesus has saved us from something. He has saved us to something. Colossians chapter 1 tells us He has delivered us from the power of darkness. That's good, but it doesn't stop there. He's delivered us from the power of darkness, and He has conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love. Our salvation is great in that Jesus does not only pardon us, Jesus promotes us. It may not seem like it at first glance, but when you look around this room this morning, you are looking at a room full of royals. It may not seem like it, but just because we don't see it at the moment doesn't make it any less true. We may not have high pedigrees, but we are no longer men of low degree. He has translated us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of His Son. He has made us kings and queens, not just in some figurative sense, but in a very literal sense. If you are trusting in Jesus Christ and you are faithful to Jesus Christ according to the Scripture, you will one day rule and reign with Him in active positions of authority on this earth. It's not just that He delivered us from something, He delivered us to something. He didn't just pardon us, He promoted us. We will one day rule with Him as co-regents, but even until then, you're looking at a room full of kings and queens. But notice He also says that He has made us priests to His God. Now, Christ is, of course, the high priest. You know that from Hebrews. In the Old Testament, the first high priest was Aaron. In my devotions this week, I came across something that was so meaningful that at first you might not think is meaningful until you see what God is illustrating to us. In Exodus chapter 28, when Moses and the people had just come out of Egypt and God is giving them His law, He gives them preparations for how the high priest is to be dressed. One of the things that was to be done for the high priest is two onyx stones were to be taken, and on those two stones, the names of Israel were to be engraved. Those stones were to then be put in settings and placed on the very shoulders of the high priest. Then on the breastplate that he wore, on the 12 stones on the breastplate that he wore, on each one of those stones, one of the names of the tribes of Israel was to be written on those stones. And what's so beautiful about that is the Scripture tells us that when Aaron wears these things on his shoulder and on his breast, the Scripture tells us that Aaron shall bear the names of the people of Israel before the Lord on his shoulders and on his heart. Jesus is the high priest who bears His people on His shoulders and on His heart at all times. He intercedes for us in the heavenly sanctuary. Both by His shed blood and His scarred body, He speaks on our behalf. But the text doesn't say He is the high priest. The text says He has made us priests to His Father. Just as Aaron was appointed the high priest, so his sons were appointed to minister in the sanctuary. The sons of Aaron were appointed by God. They were not chosen by men. The only way you could be a priest is to be born into the Aaronic, into the Levite family. The Scripture tells us that we are a chosen people. 1 Peter 2:5, chosen by God. You also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Me, you, with all our failures, we have been appointed to serve as priests before God, ministering in the holy things. And ours are not sacrifices of bulls and goats. Our sacrifices are sacrifices of praise, sacrifices of ourself. In the Old Testament, it was only the priests that had direct access to God. Yet under the New Covenant, there is no mediating class. This is where the Catholic Church gets it wrong. There is no mediating class. There is no priest who stands between me and God. As a priest, as Jesus has made me a priest after His own order, I myself can go into the presence of God without any fear of retribution, knowing I will be fully accepted because I have been born into the line of the high priest, Jesus Christ. Every believer has direct access to the Father, but it's only through the Son. Jesus has made us priests to our God. Let me show you this. In that same chapter, Exodus chapter 28, as I read on, it didn't just tell us how the priest was to be dressed. It also goes on to tell how the priest's sons, those who are not the high priest, but those who serve, how they're to be dressed. He tells them this, "For Aaron's sons you shall make tunics and sashes for them, And I just want you to hear a couple words here. And you shall make hats for them. What's their clothes to do? Their clothes are to be for glory and beauty. What I hear, Jesus is the high priest. He bears the names of his people on his shoulders. He bears the names of his people on his heart before God at all times. But I love this. We're not the high priest. We're just priests under the order of Jesus, under the order of the high priest. Yet notice this. God said he wants every one of his priests, every one of his sons, clothed in glory and beauty. Literally, we know that God gives us his righteousness, that all the righteousness of Christ is placed on us. And though it is, I love those words, God wanted even those lesser priests who did not go into the holy place, those priests who did not make the great sin offering, he wanted them to be clothed in glory and honor, glory and beauty. And that is what God does for his people, though it's thoroughly undeserved. He bestows on us his glory, his honor. He has made us beautiful. He has transformed us into kings. He has transferred us into the priestly line. This is the Son, and the letter bears his signature. Those six things about him, those six things, if we knew nothing else, those six things should make us devour the letter, shouldn't it? He made us a king. He made us priest. He's clothed us in glory and beauty. He wears our names on his shoulder and on his chest. Literally, Scripture says that our names are graven into his hands. And we neglect the letter. The signature of this letter is clear. It's legible. There's no doubt. I don't understand. I don't see any doctors here this morning, so I can say this. I don't understand how people make it that far in life. They become medical doctors. I mean, they've earned a degree and they can't write their name. Right? Have you ever been able to read a doctor's signature? It literally, it's just like a bunch of little circles. And you wonder, maybe he was so focused on getting there that, you know, he skipped first grade or something. Honestly, it just doesn't make any sense. Somebody this intelligent, you can't even read his name. On this letter, on this script, there's no doubt. It's clear and it's legible. There's no doubt about the author of this letter. It is from the Father. It is from the Spirit. It is from the Son. It is from one God. The Father has selected us. The Son has saved us. The Spirit has sealed us. Therefore, we treasure this letter, not just because of the salutation, who it's written to, not just because of the subject, what it says, what it's about. We treasure this letter because of the signature. It is written by Him who is, Him who was, Him who is to come, and from the seven spirits are who are before His throne, and from Jesus Christ. As John said at the end of talking about Jesus, to Him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Will you pray with me? Father, now I pray that you will take your word. Lord, as we try to, I say dive deep, but God, we're not even diving deep. We're really only scratching the surface of what this opening chapter of Revelation is telling us about you. We're only scratching the surface, but Lord, in just scratching the surface, we see so much. I mean, that you are God supreme in the universe. You are the Spirit who sees all things. Nothing gets by your eyes. You're the Son, the faithful witness. You're the Son, the firstborn from the dead. You're the Son, the one who has washed us in your own blood. You're the Son, the one who's made us kings and priests. God, all we can do is honestly just lift our hands and say, you're worthy of worship. From the heart, honestly say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Lord, we bow our hearts before you this morning and we thank you that in all of your greatness and all of your magnificence, you not only created us, but you made yourself known to us. Through the Word, through the Son, you've revealed yourself to us. And Father, just from our hearts this morning, we just say thank you. We thank you that we know who you are, because were it not for the Spirit, we would be blind to that truth. Father, I pray now that you'll take your word. I pray that you'll help people to begin to understand. Next week, we'll look at Revelation one more time. But after that, we'll go into these seven letters. I pray that the truths we learned in chapter one will ring in our hearts. Every time we hear you saying something in these letters to the churches, as you speak to us, we realize again, this is from the God that we discovered in Revelation 1. And therefore, it's meaningful. Therefore, it matters. Lord, please work in the hearts of your people through your word, by your Spirit. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.